Welcome. Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is great to see all of you here this morning. If you would, take a minute to take the friendship register pad and sign it and pass it down so that we have a record of who is worshiping with us and that you can see who your neighbors are if you don't know them. And a special welcome to the visitors that we have today. It's great to have you with us for this morning of worship. A couple of announcements. Next Sunday is the 2 cent a meal deacon's offering. That money goes to help the Fellowship Cup and a couple of other agencies and to support the deacon's fund. And so bring your loose change next Sunday for the 2 cent a meal offering. Also, I don't know if you've noticed, but there's some construction going on in that end of the church. That is our Building Dreams and Bridges campaign, and it is well underway. We started that with a pledge kickoff in September, and so we will take pledges from September 2015, or collect pledges from September 2015 until September 2017. So you can go ahead and start turning those in if you are ready to do that. Some have already paid. Some have paid in full. It's amazing. And so also, if you haven't turned in your annual stewardship pledge, please do that as well so that we can continue to do God's good work through your tithes and gifts. We appreciate that. And you have gone above and beyond, especially with the Building Dreams and Bridges. And so it just shows a lot about the excitement that is here about what God is doing and for the future that we will have together. Are there any other announcements this morning? Ken? Tom? Tom went to that Iowa game yesterday. I think maybe it's Levi that's kidding the Hawkeyes to play so well. It's that band
that's right.
That's holding up the football team.
He is their good luck charm.
Ah.
This weekend we will be mailing out the college care kits to our college students, and I see a couple of them here, so it will be coming. The notebooks for you to write your notes of encouragement are in the lounge for you to write a personal note to our college students. And Kyle, if you need to write down, you know, study on Tuesday night for your final, you know, you can write that down as a reminder to yourself. But please take a few minutes. I know our college students really enjoy receiving the care kits with the goodies, but also with the encouraging notes from family and friends. And then also, the sign-out sheet will be in the hallway for our press-on meals. There will be 3 Wednesday nights in December, and we greatly appreciate the support of the congregation, members who are willing to feed us on a Wednesday night. Thank you.
I don't really have any announcements, but my wife has a couple of them. Okay, we are doing lunch, the Fellowship Cup, on the, December 2nd. Somebody canceled out, and the Fellowship Cup called and asked if we would do it. We are going to do it. We're doing some casseroles from a long time ago, but we need 3 desserts. And if you would be so kind as to make, my wife put it down, 9 by 13 pans of dessert. We need 3 different ones. And if you would be so kind, either talk to her or Liz, and that would take care of me not doing a dessert for this thing. Okay, on the 6th of December, we're going to have an all-church caroling right after church. Hopefully we'll get done early so we can get this over with. We're going to Park Place and to Sunnybrook, where we have people of our church there, and we're going to do caroling. And it would be great if people that could actually sing went with us for a change. I have this dream of actually doing carols in more than one part harmony. So we'll leave right after church. We will be back before noon, hopefully, and we're going to have soup and sandwiches here at church afterwards. And we'd kind of like to know how many can make it so Susan can know how much soup to ask for. Thank you.
Thanks, Please let us stand as we are able for the call to worship. Rejoice in the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord.
In the ordinary experiences of waking and sleeping.
Rejoice in the Lord.
In times when we celebrate and even when we weep.
Rejoice in the Lord.
When a friend blesses us with kindness or a neighbor meets a need.
Rejoice in the Lord. Our opening hymn is hymn number 560. Be seated. Our hearts should open to the Lord, but they are closed. How can we not hear the cries of tribulation around us? How can we not see the pain? Why don't we speak words of love? O merciful Christ, please forgive us. Let us confess our sins together so that we may be renewed. Holy God, we admit that we abhor, that we don't understand. We belittle anyone who doesn't think like us, hope like us, believe like us, or look like us. We despise the weak and lash out at the poor when they are not directly in front of us. Yet we see, O God, when you bring us together during hardships or celebrations, we are no different. We are all your children who love and laugh and want the best. Holy Comforter, help us put aside our sin of power and control so we see the world as one. Now hear us as we confess our personal sins.
Thank you.
God knows our strengths and our weaknesses. Through confession, God shows us our faults so we may correct them and build on our gifts. He does this through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Friends, believe the good news.
Through Jesus Christ, we are called as friends. Forgive us sinners and send us servants. Thanks be to God.
Please say with me the prayer for illumination. Silence any voice in us, O Lord, so that hearing your word today, we may obey and be transformed. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Don't they sound like angels? They really do. They have a CD from the concert that they did. Martha Wiley had put it together, and it's available. And Sarah, what? No? It is. Yeah. And we were riding in the car, and Sarah said, "You have to listen to this." And she popped it in, and we sat there, and we listened to one of their songs from that concert. And it's just amazing. It transports you to another place. It's well done. So we appreciate the work that you offer to God every week. What? In my last church, Sarah sat behind me, so I couldn't see these faces that she would make. I love you. Our scripture reading for today comes from Hosea, the 11th chapter. But really what I'm preaching about is the kind of the whole book of Hosea. And if you haven't read the whole book of Hosea, it's a pretty rowdy book about God being upset at his child, Israel. And also it's about God's inner life and how God is dealing with those things. And so listen for these words from the prophet Hosea, speaking for how God may feel. From chapter 11 in Hosea. "When Israel was a child, I loved him. And out of Egypt, I called my son. But the more I called them, the more they went from me. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and offering incense to idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them up in my arms, but they did not know that I healed them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with bands of love. I was like to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down to them. I fed them. Yet they shall return to the land of Egypt, and Assyria shall be their king, because they have refused to return to me. The sword rages in their cities. It consumes their oracle priests and devours because of their schemes. My people are bent on turning away from me. To the Most High they call, but he does not raise them up. Yet the Lord says, 'How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboim? My heart, it recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, for I am God and no mortal, the Holy One in your midst. And I will not come again in wrath.'" These are the words of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Most holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart be acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, the green and pink and blue-haired adolescent child came home late again. Her parents didn't know where she was, or who she was with, or what they were doing, but they knew she didn't leave the house dressed like that. Upon her arrival home, she slid through the door, looking back at the driveway, smiling and waving at whoever it was that was driving that SUV with those dark tinted windows. Then she turned inside and shot daggers at her parents, sitting there in their respective seats and rising from the recliner and the couch. The daughter scoffed at the effort that her father used to slam the leg rest of his lazy boy. Lazy boy. "Come here, young lady," the mother demanded. And the daughter just hung her coat sloppily and said, without looking at her parents, "I'm going to bed. I'm tired." You could feel the rebellion in every step that she took down the hall. After a glance from his wife that said, "Do something," the husband blurted out, "Your mother and I want to talk with you." He meant it in a friendly way. He really wanted his daughter to share. She used to run up to him when he got home from work and babble for hours about bubbles and clouds and how she caught a snail and how it was slimy. And look, she hadn't washed her hands all day so that he could feel. But now he was in this lamp-lit living room way past anyone's bedtime. And he was shocked as he heard his own voice. He was surprised to hear how he sounded so much like his own parents when he said again, "Not so fast. We want to talk with you." His adolescent girl just said, "Whatever. I'll be here in the morning. Love you, Daddy," and slammed the door. Their baby girl was gone, and they knew it. At some point, scientists aren't sure when, our dear, sweet, little, huggable children turn into hormonal monsters. Without previous experience, but with almost divine knowledge, they can push every maddening button on a parent. While at the same time, they can evoke this glimmer of hope with one kind word like, "Love you, Daddy," while they're slamming the door in his face. Psychologists and psychiatrists don't remember how they manage such skill at that same age, and therefore they can only help others cope. But if you ask a pastor, they will tell you prophetically and honestly, there is no hope. Save for Jesus. In our scripture lesson today, Israel is described as a wayward adolescent child. And she is the one who even frustrates the creator of the world. Didn't you ever drive your parents nuts like that? Haven't your kids ever set the red lights buzzing in your head? It's like one second you're watching them with adoration, like your heart running outside of your body, and you love them so deeply, and you wonder, how could I love something so much? And the next minute, with exasperation, you realize why fathers eat their young. It's hard to believe that God could feel those same emotions about us too. But that's what we see in this scripture story today. The internal workings and emotions of God. And God is not happy. And we don't like this poetry of an angry God throwing his hands up in the air and saying, "I've had it. I've had it." As the opening chapter of Hosea begins, he says, "Fine, do whatever you want." And we don't like this violent imagery of an indifferent God. And much less do we like the language of Hosea. And if you've never read it, Hosea makes God get a little PG-13, if not rated R, when he talks about Israel's lover and how they have gone by the wayside. We don't like that God could have complex emotions of love and hate towards the harmful actions of those he loves. We just don't like these aspects of God. It is troubling. God is supposed to be omnipotent, all-knowing, all-loving, all-good, all-powerful, not emotive and reactive. There is no doubt that the God of the Bible is enmeshed in what I would say could be called rage. This is evident in God's ready mandate for Israel to destroy in ruthless ways the Canaanite population that occupies the land of promise. It is horrendous, the things that they say to do. And then that same rage burns against the Israelites when, like children, they whine about what is for dinner in the desert. Manna. Again. And God says, fine, have meat. It will make you sick. See if I care. That divine exasperation spills over once more according to prophetic imagination. God says through and through in the prophets, if you neglect your neighbors, you will be carried off by a foreign land. And God watches almost smugly, yet brokenly, as the Assyrians and the Babylonians come and conquer his children. And he is saying, basically, I told you so. Walter Brueggemann says this evidence of God's indifference and love goes powerfully against our preferred affirmations that Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. It goes against what we say when we say God is good and everyone says all the time. We can't sit comfortably with this because we must control God's message. We are in Iowa after all, and we are good political managers, and so we must manage God. God cannot be angry. God cannot love that deeply. But isn't that just another aspect of love? To hate what people do that harms themselves and others? Brueggemann says, we have developed a long-established preferred strategy for overcoming this notion of divine anger. And he says the easiest ploy is for us to say that the claims of violence attributed to God are simply human projections. We evoke God's wrath in the service of some ideology so that we can get what we want in the name of God. Well, God says, and then we get what we want. Thus, for example, violence against the Canaanites is in the service of Israel's land-hungry ideology. We want the promised land. God said we could have it, therefore we're going to kill you. That's the way it works. And even divine judgment against Israel could serve the rigorous moral passion of the prophets, who thus give divine sanction to their own ethical marauding. Well, God says you shouldn't do that, so we've done this all throughout history. God says, therefore, we will burn you at the stake. God says, therefore, we will excommunicate you from the church. God says, therefore, we can do whatever we want because we are projecting onto God whatever we think. And Brueggemann says, that's how we have handled, rightly and wrongly, this anger from God. But he says, if we treat human projection with all that we do not like in the Bible, that also means that we could projecting onto God that God is love. And to sit with that, it's a slippery slope. He goes on to say this strategy about conforming to projection on God confirms to a modern Enlightenment reason, a way to provide somehow to get past the hard parts of the testimony, of the witness to who God is. The result is a more enlightened God. a God who conforms to our reason. And yet, here is the problem with this. This projection of God we create is a God who cannot save. For in order for God to save, God must know love. And God must love us so much that God hates in anger what we do that harms us. God must know wrath in order to love so deeply that he wants to save us from those things that we need saving from, which is mostly ourselves. These texts are difficult, but they are a revelation of who God is and how God is for us. For what we see in here is that God in the Bible is a real being, not some philosophical idea that resides up here in our lofty academic heads, but a real being, in that God has an internal life full of emotion, just like us. And we see God's own ongoing resolve to be faithfully God, loving, caring, and with us. Listen again to what it says in Hosea. And this is after God rails against them for chapters because they do human sacrifice to the Baals. That's what it means when he said they sacrifice to the Baals. It means that they were tossing people into a pit, right? That doesn't make God happy. This is after he says, these people love their technology more than they love worshiping me, for those who are on their iPhones right now. This is after God says they prefer their own ideological debates over loving their neighbors. Sounds like refugees, doesn't it? I can't make this stuff up. It's right there in the Bible. And so God is mad at these folks for doing these things. And God is literally fit to be tied. And yet, we see God's internal struggle. Because he says, in a moment of reflective self-awareness, but how can I give you up, O Ephraim, his child? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboim, places that were like Sodom and Gomorrah, destroyed? And get this, sit with this for a minute. God says, I used to pick you up and kiss your cheeks. He says, God, the creator of the world, says, I used to hold your hand when you were learning to walk. So he says, in the face of all we have done, my heart recoils within me. It jumps back, his heart. And he says, my compassion grows warm and tender. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, a promise. And he says, for I am no mortal. I am God, the Holy One in your midst, and I will not come again in wrath. And with this, God's inner life is revealed. It was the same love that sent God to the cross in Christ. And here we see a real being with real emotions. And yes, God gets angry. But it is a revelation to know that God cares. And here's the takeaway for us. God can practice self-control in a way that we cannot. And so my prayer is that when your anger burns inside of you, you remember in whose image you were made, the one whose compassion overcomes his anger, who says, I will not come again in wrath. And so may you be one whose compassion rules and governs your life. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let us stand and sing our next hymn. It's printed in your bulletin there, the number. Let us remain standing and say together what we believe, reciting the Apostles' Creed printed in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. As people of faith, we come to this place set apart to connect with God and the world, and we are encouraged to take time to pray for our world, our nation, our community, our families, our friends, and our church. So as God's people call to love one another, let us pray, saying, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, we pray that churches of all traditions may discover their unity in Christ and exercise their gifts in service of all. We pray to you, O God, hear our prayer. That the earth may be freed from war, famine, and disease, that we may smash our swords into plowshares, so that people shall be fed, and so that the world will know peace. We pray to you, O God, hear our prayer. That those who govern and maintain peace in every land may exercise their powers in obedience to your commands, and those who seek power may only seek power to do your will and not harm. We pray to you, O God, hear our prayer. That you will preserve all who live and work in this city. Keep us in peace and safety, and bless us as we are neighborly to one another. We pray to you, O God, hear our prayer. That you will comfort and empower those who face any difficulty or trial, the sick, especially those we know in our hearts whom we name before you now in silence. Holy God, we ask that you heal in those we love and those who we don't know, that those who are able to have healing, that you heal them in wonders and ways beyond all they may ever dream or hope. And for those whose life is coming to an end and going by the way of the earth by which all things go, we pray that you can heal them in spirit so that they may know your truth and comfort and hope and love in eternal life. We pray all of these things in Christ's name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We give because God first gave to us. In the Bible, Hebrews 13:16 says, Do good and share what you have, for such generosity is pleasing to the Lord. Let us share our tithes and offerings.
Well, I hope you all have a good Thanksgiving. And when you are in your house together, remembering your family and living out again those childhood battles with parents and siblings, I hope you can find joy and thanksgiving. And remember that God has anger and irritants too. And God loves us deeply. And so I hope you can love your family that way as well. So go with the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.